You know, I've always felt that artists have a huge responsibility because the culture looks at them as a way of interpreting what's going on. I think it's important for artists to be redeeming, offer things that are redeeming, things that are going to lift people, encourage them. So you do have to be careful with what you say and what the material is, because there's a lot of material out there that bleeds violence.
I spent quite some time in my life with Bob Marley as marketing manager of Tuff Gang Records. What would Bob Marley really say to young artists of today? Marley never really was a person who spoke a lot on the opinions of how people conduct their life. Marley was more a great listener. His music was a lot about purpose. Every man have a right to decide his own destiny. He said to me one day, you know, the man who breed my mother is a white man. So I know why I'm here. A white man and a black woman come together to have me. So I can't be against black, I can't be against white. So my music must be used to unite the people of all race, all class, all color, all creed, all religion.
One love, one heart, let's join together and I feel alright. One love, one of mercy.
Unity and love, and above all, truth. He says, tell the children the truth. You will find this repeated in his music. And of course, he's always against a system of oppression, fighting against easy man schism. When you need to get some food, your brother got to be your enemy, and it's an ambush in the night. That is out of the system. Remember, he says the Babylon system is a vampire, sucking the blood of the sufferer. Another thing is about money. What are you doing this thing for? It's about money. You remember when somebody said to Bob, know that you are rich. How do you relate to your brothers? He said, rich, what do you mean by rich? And the brother said to him, know that you have money. He said, money makes you rich? No, money don't make me rich. Life is what makes me rich. These are some of the things Bob would be saying to the young people. And he would be saying, look to the Creator. When Bob says, give us the teachings of His Majesty, because we don't want the devil's philosophy. And what is the teachings of His Majesty? Until that philosophy, which holds one race superior and another inferior, is finally and totally abolished and abandoned, then the world shall know no peace. His Majesty also said, for whatsoever language the Bible is written, it remains one and the same. It's a guide to your past, your present, and your future. Within it, you'll find the truth for yourself. One love, one heart. Let's get together and be all right.
Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, and participants from around the world, I've seen at least one person from Belize, the little that I got to see, and there might be others. People from the Caribbean Christian Leadership Network, that is the people that I'm a part of here, we want to welcome you to today's panel discussion on a topic that holds immense significance to Jamaican culture. It's the message in the music. I suspect that we will focus in largely on dancehall, which dominates the space today, though the Jamaican musical influence is much more diverse than that. I'm honored to be your moderator for this engaging and thought-provoking session. I'm David Pearson, pastor at Mona Heights Chapel. Jamaica, known for its rich heritage, vibrant rhythms, and cultural diversity, has given birth to numerous musical art forms that have captured the world's imagination and attention. Among these, ska, rocksteady, reggae and dancehall have each stood as pillars of expression, resonating not only within the country, this country, but reaching global audiences. Today we gather virtually to delve into the profound impact that our music's message has had on Jamaican society and elsewhere. I lived in Trinidad and Tobago for a while, and the biggest music down there was Trinidad song, coming straight out of Jamaica. Through this discussion, we aim to explore the role of popular music as a powerful medium for social commentary, cultural identity, and artistic representation. And since CCLN has a Christian concern, we will also explore the role of the church in these matters. Our esteemed panelists who bring a wealth of knowledge and experience to this platform will shed light on various aspects of the topic. They will share their perspectives on how our music has influenced the socio-political landscape, shaped the Jamaican identity, and provided a platform for marginalized voices to be heard. No doubt, we'll also explore the lyrical content, its reflection of social realities, and the impact it has in shaping attitudes and behaviors among different generations. We'll also discuss the responsibility of artists, producers, and might I say, the church, and the wider community in preserving the authenticity of our music while addressing issues of spirituality, gender, violence, and social justice. We'll explore the ways in which our music has both empowered individuals and faced criticism for its portrayal of certain themes. It is our hope that through our time together this afternoon, we will gain a deeper understanding of the intricate relationship between our music, our spirituality, and our culture. We aim to foster respectful and inclusive dialogue, embracing diverse perspectives and acknowledging the complex nature of this topic. I encourage all participants to actively engage in this conversation, to ask questions, and to share your insights and experiences. Let us collectively explore the far-reaching impact of the message of our music and its enduring influence on our culture and society. It is now my pleasure to introduce to you our main presenter, Reverend Dr. Stephen Jennings. Reverend Jennings is a pastor of Mona Baptist Church, Kingston, and is an esteemed lecturer at the United Theological College of the West Indies. The title of his presentation is An Overview of the Trajectory of Jamaican Music Since Independence.
Good to be here with everybody. I'm probably more, my title, David, is a little more modest than yours for Jamaican music and trajectories. I seem to have a title called Jamaican Popular Music, and I should say that's put Jamaica, but Jamaican Popular Music and its message, all right? And I'll tell you why that is important in a moment. Well, not in a moment, towards the end. Let's perhaps deal with a kind of historical overview of Jamaican popular music. Jamaican popular music started long before Jamaica was independent. I know that our focus is on independent Jamaica, but really it's about the fact that Jamaica existed for millennia of centuries, of course. And then when the Europeans came, the First Nations people were virtually wiped out, and later Africans were imported from West Africa to substitute for the labor supply of the Europeans. Those West Africans came as enslaved people, as we all know, but they did not come without their own culture, and music being one of them. So what we have is the fact that Caribbean people have always brought their music from West Africa and shaped that music in terms of what they had to deal with. So if they encountered Europeans from Ireland, for instance, some of their music would be shaped by that. If they encountered people from England, same way, you know, Germany, wherever, French, same way. So things like Calypso and Trinidad, some of that would have had some French influence, but the large majority of the influence would have been from Western Central Africa, which is where the majority of Caribbean people came from. So I won't go into that history. Others on this chat are more qualified to talk about that than I am. But that is a reality, and that Afro-Caribbean shaping is present all throughout the Caribbean and its diasporas, and that needs to be told, because that really is a root and foundation of it. Things like drums and bass and syncopation in terms of where beats fall and so on, dances, and all of those things reflect our Afro-Caribbean heritage, and it is still a part of it and it's not going anywhere. All right? Now, to Jamaica, and again the Caribbean in particular, there was, from the 1900s into the 1950s, even early 60s, a kind of Caribbean music called, Afro-Caribbean music called mento. Mento was a music where strings were used a lot, banjos and guitars and a lot of percussions, things like, you know, what we call shakers and so on. And again, the rhythm was playful in a sense, but the lyrics were often very profound, albeit sounding simple and so on, but working at a certain kind of level to make points about society and different things which we'll see just now. And mento was that kind of beat that characterized Caribbean culture for years in different versions. You know, it was similar to music, for instance, out of Cuba, merengue, was Cuba music in Trinidad, Kaiso, and so on. But mento in Jamaica was a really established music. It was often confused with calypso, which emerged during the same time in Trinidad. Again, similar kind of approaches to themes, social commentary and so on, but different in terms of emphasis of beat and so on. But from the people outside, for the people outside of the region, all of the region was the same. They were just becoming aware of it, particularly North America. And so that's how they discovered things like salsa and Sambo in Brazil. They discovered mento and calypso in the Caribbean and called it calypso. And so when people like Harry Belafonte singing some of these songs made them popular in the 1950s, and his own popularity as he releases album, the first million selling album called Calypso in 1950, it kind of just shot Caribbean music into this international profile, particularly North America and Western Europe. But it was called calypso, but really technically much of it wasn't calypso, it was mento, and Jamaica was a champion of that. So people came as tourists to Jamaica in the 50s, for instance, and danced to what they thought was calypso, but really was mento music. All right, now having said that, we want to go now to the next thing coming down to independent Jamaica. When Jamaica became independent in 1962, there was a conscious decision to make Jamaican popular music sound different from regular Afro-Caribbean and mento music, which, as I said, was, you know, sounding similar to other parts of the Caribbean. There's a bit of music that had been coming out of West Kingston, which itself was a form of Afro-Caribbean music, but which was far more pacey, lively, if you will, where people could dance, or as they call it then, jive in a certain kind of way, and it had a lot more movements of hand and foot and so on. It was called ska, and later on had a lot of horns in it, thanks to a group called the Scatolites, which was an Afro-Caribbean group influenced a lot by North American R&B and jazz, and Ibek Hulan and Fonso and Don Drummond and Macook Brothers and so on, caused ska to become really, really popular. And because Jamaica was becoming independent, and because Jamaica wanted this kind of distinct identity coming out of West Indian Federation. It wanted to be its own thing. Ska became the music of the new Jamaica. So Jamaican music between 62 and 66, the popular music was ska. It was deliberately introduced from downtown to uptown Kingston and then across the country in different ways and places. It also became international as Jamaica took this to world music festivals and other things in the United States, in Canada, during this period. And look at the record of this period, which show that ska was promoted deliberately as Jamaica's national music. It doesn't mean that Minta wasn't sitting there in other forms. And even his presentation, I should have said that there are always other forms such as Euro-Western classical music, which never died, Afro-American gospel songs and gospel spirituals, in particular so-called Negro spirituals, but we're focusing on the music that emerged out of Jamaica, so to speak, at this stage. So ska is this Jamaican music, 1962 to 66. Ska, as I said, was very pacey and lively and fast, but after a while, even the best of drummers just couldn't keep up with that kind of beat. And so from the people who practice it, something called rocksteady emerged, because they literally were trying to slow down this beat so they could keep up. But it also reflected a Jamaica that was beginning to become a little bit disillusioned with the early promise of independence from as early as 1966. People were still facing poverty, inequality. There was a beginning to be an increase in a certain kind of crime and violence in the cities and so on. And rocksteady reflected that pace, both in terms of the theme as well as the tempo. And so from 1966 to 1968, there is this rocksteady era that emerges. And then it continued. But during this rocksteady era, there was something else emerging. And I need to just put it here. There was something called dub. Dub had emerged from the 1950s with a man called Count Machucci. And dub was really a kind of space where one side of our record, because it was vinyl those days, was filled up by the same rhythm, but with people talking over that rhythm in all kinds of ways, giving all kinds of messages. So that talking over it became as known as dub, because the vinyl record was a dub plate of the original record. And out of that, we had people who were selectors, you know, people like King Stitch and so on. And with that sound, who was a better sound, who could chant better? So apart from the record itself, which everybody had, you know, playing or heard playing on jukeboxes and radio and the like, you also had in these specific spaces the competition as to who was the better sound, who carried the better selector with the better messaging. Out of that, DJs, disc jockeys emerged, and that helped people to have versions, different versions of them, and a jive to them. And so what we have here is that, you know, that we had versions, we had, and so on. And out of that, you had people like King Stitch, who can forget man like U Roy, Big Youth, and with them producers like Lee Perry, Scratch Perry, later on King Tubby's in Jamaica. And that's important because three major musics of the world emerged from this era of dub, right? One of them was hip hop, and with it, it's cousin rap, because people from Jamaica, notably a guy called King Herc, who this year is being inducted into the Music Hall of Fame, they brought from Jamaica into the rooms of Brooklyn in house parties their dub version, but with American accents. It became rap and hip-hop, right? And people remember songs like Rapper's Delight and so on. But all of this emerged out of that. So So this year they're celebrating 50 years of hip-hop, and the rap is like the DJ messaging. It came from Jamaica, right? So hip-hop and rap owes its their origin to Jamaica and to that dub era from 68 into the early 70s. And then dancehall, which we will look at shortly, comes out of that era of what became known as chanting or toasting. It became out of this dub era. The dub also marks a transition from rock steady to reggae. Reggae, we usually associate with the 1970s. Technically, some reggae started from the late 60s, 68, 69. In fact, Toots Hibbert, who is the one who is alleged to have given the name reggae, actually had said that reggae, the word reggae came out of a term which was popular in Jamaica at the time, and some of us who were living in that era would know the term. The term was trege, right? And to be a trege means that you're a kind of stray, meaning that you are somebody who didn't have quote unquote a certain kind of breeding, but you are prone to be wild and you're often looked down and despised. So according to Toots, who wrote a song called Do This Trege, for him it was really that Jamaican music was this wild and tame music that people looked down on, but really was the people's music. And out of trege came reggae, and the name stuck. And so the idea was that this was the people's music. It was a slowdown, even slower version of rocksteady, whereas rocksteady was, yes, as it sounded, a kind of steady beat. Reggae was ultra slow, and it was really, you know, drum, bass, a kind of slow dancing, more gyrating to the hips, working in one little section than the fast pace ska or even rock steady that demanded more space. Again, probably reflecting also population growth where people could pack into smaller spaces to do their thing. But it's reggae, and reggae came on at a time when black consciousness was emerging all across the world, and Jamaica was no exception. Black identity was beginning to reaffirm in the United States with civil rights in this early 60s, black power later on, and how all of that filtered through popular music. People remember James Brown's song, Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud, for instance, or Nina Simone's To Be Young, Gifted and Black, which Bob Andy and Master Griffiths covered, I think, in 71, 72. And, you know, the Afro Hair, the Dashikis, you know, Fist, the Power for the People, and so on. All of those were there. But also, Rastafari had come into a new phase. Rastafari was in Jamaica from the 1930s, when people had their own epiphany about Haile Selassie and his own role in the salvation of black people. And was there working through filtering through Jamaica and Kingston and St. Thomas and St. James. But, sisters and brothers, in the 1970s, by 1970, it had emerged in a certain kind of way because of the coming of Haile Selassie to Jamaica in 1966, the Ethiopian Orthodox Church being present and making that link between Western Christianity that people are accustomed to and a kind of Christianity that affirmed the African self. And reggae became a vehicle for the messages of Rastafari, the resurgent Rastafari. And we know that it was present before. People like Jimmy Cliff were singing reggae before, for instance, How Did They Come was there. But even in that film, where a lot of reggae music was present and introduced to a wider world, already Rastafari was present. You know, Pedro, the character played by Ras Daniel Hartman, who was a well-known Rasta, conveyed a kind of positive vibe and energy about Rastafari. So the music became linked with Rastafari, and increasingly, as you hear the music of of the 70s, you begin to hear that War with a Babylon is won by Max Romeo. Emerging, you know, Johnny Clark, Move Out of Babylon is one of them. Master Griffith, Stepping Out of Babylon is another one. And of course, the Wailers, Wailing Wailers with Bob Marley. They had been a ska group, rock steady group, you know, R&B soul group. But by then, they had changed and become Rastafari. And in becoming that, their own music was changed. So some of what they used to sing to ska beats became reggae beats, and the lyrics became much more conscious Rastafari, and the themes of Rastafari, which I reflect on in a little. So there's reggae there, and there are two major forms of reggae: roots rock reggae, right, which focused on what people call conscious music, and the lyrics were about society and for change and so on. Again, we'll talk about that, about themes and how they. And then there was always lovers rock. There, you know, you wanted the kind of music that would soothe people's soul. You know, you think of Dennis Brown, who did a lot of that. Love Has Found His Way, you know. Later on, Gregory Isaacs and so on, whatever that. And Bob has his own lovers rock, you know. Turn the lights down low. Is it this love that I'm feeling? Could you be loved? All of those reflected the lovers rock genre of reggae music. Then by the 80s, something shifted. That whole consciousness of the 70s, which was not just about Rastafari, but about continued themes of Black Power and so on, moved, and the whole matter of, you know, socialism and all of that, democratic socialism, all of that era in the 1970s was an era of great ferment in the society. That shifted in the 1980s, where, just like Calypso in Trinidad, it gave way to people wanting something lighter, something less dealing with social issues and so on, and something that was dealing far more with entertainment. People enjoying themselves, you know, they never want to dance, go hear the same problems talked about that they were escaping from. They wanted something good. And dancehall now as a space, but also as a genre of music, exploded. As I said before, the precursor of that was dub, right? With the whole matter of people, you know, expressing their own unique messages and toasting and competing and dancing and having a crowd with them and having their own kind of crew and what became known as posse and so on. And that reflected that. And so dancehall of the 1980s was something different. It was lighter, it was still the same reggae music, but it was much more dealing with, you know, the funnier things of life, or the more entertaining things of life. And we look at the theme just now. But it also coincided with a certain kind of technological shift that was happening in the world that came into Jamaica. People remember things like Casio phones and calculators. Well, they also had Casio to give a free commercial. Pianos and keyboards that would now distort the voice, or not distort, but change up voices and the music coming out every time. You could do far more rather than employ a whole studio to play drum and bass and all that, like the reggae era would do, or even the ska era. What you'd find out is that you could do more with technology. And so EDM type music emerged, electronic dance music, really, because the music was here. Again, it was global, but it became part of dancehall. So people remember the Sling Thing rhythm, for instance. And that rhythm alone generated so many versions of a song. And that was an era when people started to build rhythms and make rhythms. And that has continued to this day. And dancehall now has become something called trap music, which is, a technique of building certain rhythms in certain ways. And as the technology has emerged, people can literally use their computer, like I'm using mine and you're using yours or your tablet or whatever, and build a rhythm and then build a song around the rhythm. So dancehall reflected that, but also dancehall reflected the festivals that were happening. We already had in the 70s things like reggae Sunfest, wrong, Sunsplash, and then Sunfest emerged as its successor. But you had, now with dancers, people going to different places to emerge, and you had clashes, and who can forget the clashes between the famous guys, the Ninja and the Bounty and the, you know, Shabba and the Beanie and the, you know, all of that. Those are all part of that. Yellow Man was there before much of the techno emerged, talking about particular themes. But again, dancehall emerges in the 80s. When I say something emerges, it doesn't mean the others fade away, but it means the others become the majority of people talk about. In the 90s, there's again a shift. The dancehall is there, and more and more people making their names for themselves. You don't stop to look for the music of the 90s, and you find more DJs, more singers, more people, you know, doing serious kinds of music, playful kind of music, all kinds of music. But in the early 90s, there emerges a reggae revival, where particular artists felt that the music had become too materialistic and reflected too much of the spirit of that age, and needed to have some of that conscious lyric come back and conscious beat come back. And so you had people like Garnet Silk and people like Tony Rebel emerging in this era, people like Luciani emerging in this era, later people like Kipatan and Sizzla emerging, and of course someone like Buju Banton, who was, you know, a dancehall baby, really one who was bearing the flags of dancehall with all of the themes of dancehall. Buju became converted to Rastafari in the early 90s and put out a still classic album called Till the Child Come, and you know, where he revisits some of the themes of the 70s, but for a 90s audience, and people who knew him would have known of the change and seen that reggae revival. So these guys and others embodied that, and later on, people like, you know, Prodigy, Chronix, and so on, would have dipped deep into this catalog and this genre for their own making as they emerged. In the 2000s, reggae dancers, Kia Rocksteady, not only existed together in the Jamaican scene, but world beats, where the whole world was dancing to these things. As a matter of fact, the UNESCO, United Nations Education, Scientific and Cultural Organization, they declared, with some push on the Jamaican government, declared these musics to be world music. And to say that Jamaica in general, and Kingston in particular, has produced four beats for the world and four forms of music: ska, rocksteady, reggae, dancehall, and if you put hip hop in there, it would be five, you know, hip hop, rap. And so they had the world status, and that reflected the fact that globally, wherever you were, these kinds of music, you could hear them all over. Europe had some of the biggest reggae festivals. Japan had the own version of Sunsplash, and you could get vinyl records there to buy. Dancehall became popular everywhere. India, Dubai, wherever you went, rocksteady, you could find that. Ska, you could find that. And ska bands became popular in places like India, in Italy, and so on. People cross-fertilizing. And so what you have is fusion, a lot of fusion music taking place, fusing different kinds of music, and that happened. And that was throughout the 2000s, and still is so to a great extent. The last bit of history that is important is to know that Jamaican music is not only influenced by trap music now, but also by music, popular music. It is influenced by something called Afrobeats. Afrobeats really emerge in the African space, particularly in West Africa, Central Africa, in Eastern Africa, in places like Kenya and Uganda. But it became marketed and pushed through African diaspora people from Africa, not through the Caribbean, but through North America and through Britain in particular. And Afrobeats now is the beat that really is driving a lot of what we hear in circles. In fact, songs like I Know Who I Am in church circles is an Afrobeat song, right? You know, and you know, different kind of songs, people like Burna Boy and so on. they are the ambassadors of Afrobeat, and a lot of young people dance to that. And when Burna Boy came here the other day, the place was full. I mean, more people probably could have come, but the place was full. It was still COVID time. And people could sing the song word for word, like how they could sing a dancehall song word for word in the 90s or, you know, reggae song in the 70s, which means that this is the music of younger people and so on. And so, interestingly, our music in Jamaica, popular music, came from Africa. And now we are ourselves going back to Africa in that kind of way. And in fact, many of these guys, they try to speak with a Jamaican accent, and they accentuate the fact that there's this link between, you know, Nigeria and Jamaica, or Ghana and Jamaica, and why, you know, no problem, we are all one black people. And you hear it, you hear the West African idiolect, but you also hear the attempts at the Caribbean and Jamaica in particular. So Afrobeat is where it's at, and right now that's the music that's there. But all of these other musics are present, it's just what is popular. So I've talked about the types and phases of Jamaican popular music, and that survey, I think, we covered a lot. The other parts are not as long, but I thought that would leave some kind of thought for us. Some themes of Jamaican popular music is my second major heading. And it's interesting to listen to these things over a period of time. I had the privilege of doing so. Grew up with a lot of this music, you know. Jamaican popular music is part of the soundtrack to my own life. So a lot of this is you know, based on songs that we know. But again, when you do the research, you find it. Songs like Migration, the songs that talk about migration, that people going back. So for instance, from Harry Belafonte days, you hear about the Jamaica Farewell. I'm sad to say, I'm on my way, we'll be back for many a day. And Harry is talking about having to leave a little girl in Kingston Town, you know, that he's here and he has to travel. He's reflecting people who went to places like Panama or, you know, Great Britain or United States or even Costa Rica or Cuba, you know, that they have to migrate, that idea of leaving. So reflecting the whole matter of you know, migration, that's a strong theme. And then you had, you know, internal migration, a disappointment with life, particularly city life, so, and an idealizing of country life or Africa or heaven. Again, these themes come through African diaspora music a lot. You know, when people talk about sooner we'll be done with the troubles of the world, I'm going to live with God. That's the African diaspora disappointment, the life of slavery, and disappointment is really a mild word. You know, people just tired of this and, you know, want to go home. You have, you know, people singing, you know, I think of Otis Redding sitting on the dock of the bay, watching the tide roll away. That's someone who want leaving home from Georgia and, you know, want to go back from California, Georgia, in my mind. You could talk about all kinds of music. In the context of Jamaica, you had songs like I've Got to Go Back Home, Bob Andy's classic, reflecting that, okay? So you had that kind of thing. And then there are countless songs that are songs about romance, relationship between man and woman, for instance. Sex and sexuality, talking about real sex, want to have sex with you, having sex with you, that is a theme. And that's not a theme just for dancehall of the 80s, people. You go back, all the way back, Mento had a lot of those. Ska had a lot of that, reggae had that, you know, and about, you know, romance, sexuality, relationship. The difference, you see, is that back in the days of, say, Ska or Mento, right, or even early reggae, certain things were not played on the air. They were not to be performed in front of children. And they were only for a certain kind of people at a certain time. So, for instance, those were the things you play after hours for adults only. Like a you know, movie would back in the day, for instance, would be R and all of that would be, or A would be for adults at a certain time, and they would even show it on TV. Same with the music. It reflected a certain time. After that, though, by the, you know, the 80s, when, you know, people were just emphasizing everything anywhere, and were more open to all kinds of cultures, including North American and your Western cultures, where sex was always in the forefront, people now started to sing more explicitly sexual songs. And with cross-fertilization, rap and all of that, you know, Jamaican popular music reflected more and more that. It was not there and present and being sung. It just was for certain audiences. No, it was for everybody. So songs of romance, songs about sexuality, songs about relationship, that's part of the theme of Jamaican popular music. Then Jamaican popular music, and we have led the world in this, has been a pillar and a foundation when it comes to talking about societal and systemic injustice and the need for resilience to stand up to it, resistance, reform, and revolution, right? So resistance is left out of it, but it can be. Resilience, how you manage to keep going, you know? And you find that all the way through, you know, resistance, you know, Beres Hammond's putting up resistance is the classic for this. Reform, the society need to change, you know? Revolution. So what are we talking about? Desmond Dekker and the Aces, song 68, 69, song of, you know, poor Israelites talking about the injustice of the society, wake up every morning begging for bread, so make sure dirty and tear up. I mean, look, mine have to be like Bonnie and Clyde. From that kind of song, 69, straight back to, you know, the Dennis Brown, are we ready for the Black Revolution? You know, Beres' song I just quoted. Are you dealing with, you know, people talking about, you know, from the governor talking about in need to get, you know, a change in the society. Baby Cham talking about it, Cham now. Our chronics talking about Ghetto Paradise in 2017. We're talking about the same kind of genre. Society is unjust, it's unequal, it's unfair. We need to change it. Bob Marley and the Wailers, many of their classic songs are about that. It's about changing the world. It's about changing the country, the concrete jungle, just the need for people to change. And even dancehall reflected that idea that, why, when it was serious, that it needed to change the world and you know, certain things need to change, fire burn upon it and so on. That whole social injustice, this was a clear part of this, all right? And then, you know, this is what some people hear mostly. There was definitely a side in the quest to change society that focused on guns and the need for guns to do this. Now, again, guns were becoming more and more part of society. They've been present from the 1960s in terms of putting in the hands of people for political advantage. But as they emerged and weaned away from the formal political system, there are guns, there are gangs as part of the transnational change where guns and gangs and drugs are part of a more violent world, and the Caribbean was caught up in that, and Jamaica was one of the nodal points for that. The songs naturally would reflect what was going on in society. So, you know, people talk about them, you know, them nine and them Glock and that continues to now. The idea of gangs, you know, we are this and that. So even though, you know, there are people who are saying, boy, you know, this was just metaphorical. And it was many times. It was not just metaphorical. It was sometimes reflecting straight in society. Guns and the need for violence to do particular things. All right? Ganja was a major theme, and it has been a major theme of Jamaican popular music. Again, because of people's own choice, ganja being seen as sacramental by some Rastafari. But just generally as a thing for the people, from the people, for the people. So Peter Tosh's Legalize It was a popular anthem. That, and as that spread to other places of the world where people had similar thoughts about ganja, including the medicinal use of ganja, songs about ganja become popular. You know, herb and kali weed and so on. That was there from a long, long time. And not just by Rastafarians, it's not about Rastafarians, it's about Jamaican people feeling that this thing that grows in their place is good for people economically, medicinally, and so on. All right? Then another theme is about religion, right? believe it or not, Jamaican popular music had a lot of religion, especially Rastafari and Christianity. Actually, Christianity predates Rastafari when it comes to Jamaican popular music. Who can forget people like Otis Wright when early reggae was starting, and it was even reggae. It was a kind of almost, you know, rock steady type thing. But, you know, someday I go where Jesus is. And I love that man from Galilee. Otis Wright was what they played at church functions in the country where I grew up, you know. And even some people had problems with that because that was too worldly. But he was trying to use popular music. People like Claudia Clark, who were, you know, early pioneers in the 70s of reggae music, and then of Christian music being recorded. You had, of course, bands like, you know, David Keane and the Sunshine Singers. You had, you know, different bands like that playing reggae music, and later in the 90s, Birthright and so on. You know, Birthright was from the 80s, really, but reflecting that. So you had a lot of Jamaican music. Later on, people got, you know, particular so-called secular artists got saved, people like Pastor Junior Tucker, people like Judy Mort, people like Papa San and so on, Sitchi. They brought a whole new set with them because these were exponents of reggae and dancehall of the various genres. And they came in with that kind of sensibility, but were firmly Christian. And that, particularly in the late 90s, swept Jamaican popular music and continues to be influential, even though some of these persons are not recording as much. Carlene Davis, would I forget Carlene, and so on, right? Rastafari had its own religion. We know about that because, as I said earlier, from the early 70s, Rastafari used the religion of their reggae to be a vehicle for their religion. So, you know, people were talking like Rastafari when they were not I and I, Irie, you know, the themes of going back to Zion, of fighting against Babylon and the system, all of those were things that people talked about and spoke about because Rastafari had used reggae as part of its way of getting through to the popular people. And so religion is a key part of that. And people like Bob Marley, for instance, used a lot of the Bible for his songs, and Luciano as well, you know, with his songs. One final thing I want to highlight, and you can talk about it, we can talk about it. There's a lot in Jamaican music about celebrating life. In fact, the world comes to Jamaica because of that. What young people now call simply vibing, you know. A lot of Jamaican music talks about vibing and just having a good time, you know. From Bob song, Long Time, We Don't Have No Nice Time, you know, all the way, you know, jamming. I want to jam with you. Those are just about vibing, you know. You could choose a whole heap of music by Youngstar's Prodigy or Dance by Ding Dong or Ravers. It's about life. It's about celebration of life, you know, life of whole heap of bad things to it, people getting murdered, killed, inequality and that. But hey, listen, while we're here, let's just enjoy life and just have a good time. As Ernie Smith's 72 song said, life is just for living. Let's just live. And, you know, and that's a real theme of Jamaican popular music. All right. So there are several: migration, disappointment with life, idealizing our country life, Africa, heaven, romance, sexuality, relationships, societal injustice, the need for resilience, resistance, reformation, and revolution, gangs, guns, violence, ganja, religion, celebrating our life. These are some of the themes. Just going to mention these, and you can, you know, talk about them if you wish. Satire is one of the things, the ways in which we talk about techniques, both oral, what we speak about, oral, what we hear, because that's critical, because a lot of music is for hearing, for consumption, how people hear, and literary, what people read, and in that order. It's far to go, what we spoke, what we heard, what we said, word, sound, and power. Satire. And satire means you look at something and you talk about something else, but you're really teasing and poking fun of something and using kind of way. We don't use it as much in Jamaica. Classic calypso, you know, use that, you know, when Sparrow finds that song, there was a man in my bedroom, and I thought it was you, you know, referencing the late Queen Elizabeth. That's satire, right? Humor, of course, comes with that. A lot of mental music had humor, and as heavy as other musics were, like ska, rock steady, and reggae were, like roots reggae, there's a lot of humor still in Jamaican music, you know? Dance hall had its fair share. You know, man, I'm getting married in the morning. She have me yellow baby and she's going to mind me. That's humor. A lot of that is a technique that we use. Then double entendre, which are puns, plays on words, usually risky or indecent. In the earlier phase of this, people use a lot of that in cemento and for Caribbean music on a whole, a lot of risky music, right? People, you know, speaking this, but really meaning this, particularly when you deal with sexually innuendo, but also, you know, so other things, you know, captain, your ship is sinking, you know, captain, the seas are rough. That's a Trinidad and Calypso. But you had songs like that in Jamaica that were important. I mean, even to talk about Babylon and so on, it's really using metaphor. From the Bible, but using it in a certain way, as the Bible itself uses. And of course, there's straight talk. People make it plain. And Jamaican music has had this reputation of just talk of the things, of say the thing like how it is. Plain talk, no doubt about it, no water in the mouth. As Jamaican people tend to be, they want to say something's wrong, they're going to say it, and so on, at the risk of that. And freedom of speech is something that we really should celebrate in Jamaica. Because while it can be used excessively, unlike some places in the world, people can really express themselves, including artistically, and not be locked up or jailed like people are in the place. So it's no wonder Jamaican music, Jamaican popular music, is often the music of the soundtrack of the world, say in movies or novels and so on. For the music of freedom, because it's not just about the content, but the fact that in Jamaica, people can talk and tend to talk straight about things and can, quote unquote, get away with it. So whenever people want to say something, they have to say the hero is going to do this, the heroine is going to do this, they have this reggae beat, boom, do, 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 coming through to say, hey, this is what we're going to do. We're going to talk to him, we're going to confront, we're going to deal with the evil Babylon system that's coming straight out of Jamaican culture. So there's a straight talk about that, all right? Let me give you some final thoughts on Jamaican popular music, and then we are going to comments and questions. First, we have to always remember when dealing with any form of music, but particularly popular music, that really we're talking about the distinction between descriptive and prescriptive. Descriptive is saying, okay, this is what is happening in society. So say we're talking about guns. That's what I'm talking about guns. This is about what is actually happening. Right? We are just reflecting what is in society. People have Glock, people have N16, people have, you know, them nine and so on and so forth. So we are not just, we're just saying what we see. Right? People shoot up people kill up people, you know, whatever. People smoke herb, whatever. But describe it. Other people argue that music is prescriptive. They say it is telling people what to do. Say we talk about guns, you're there to telling people take up gun and shoot, right? You will kill somebody. Well, I'm going to kill the boy. No, that might be metaphorical dance or talk to say I am going to conquer verbally my enemy. But some people saying, but when you say it like that, you are prescribing to people that if you kill people physically, with a gun or with whatever, you know, not with the mouth, but with a gun. And so there is this debate about which is prescriptive and which is descriptive. Is it both? Is it one more than the other? That debate will go on till kingdom come, you know. Some people feel that we're dealing with a prescriptive kind of thing. Some people descriptive. They are the same thing about rap and hip hop and other forms of music. You can enter that debate. I'm just lifting it up. Then, majority versus minority. We talk about Jamaican popular music, but how popular is popular music? Is it reflecting the majority of the people and what they think and what they're going through? Or is it reflecting a minority of people who have great influence? Again, this debate happens a lot. The word popular, for instance, in Spanish, really doesn't mean just popular in terms of the majority, but it means of the people. I'm coming to that in a second. But the idea is this really reflecting everybody in the society or many people in the society or a few? Again, this debate happens because there are people who feel that why don't reflect the majority, reflect a few people who are cleverly manipulating others, including young people, including the masses, and so on and so forth. And this is the kind of thing, right? So, you know, this is a debate that people have, and you have heated debate, and people are even friends follow because of this. The last thought I want to reflect, again, I'm just lifting it up, and so everything in the lecture we can expand through the panel. Indigenization versus commercialization. Does this music of Jamaican music, all the way through, but particularly now, does it reflect what is coming out of the ordinary people of Jamaica? Right? Or is it reflecting the commercialization where music, in order to be heard, in order to be funded and bankrolled by people here and elsewhere, have to fit into certain kind of genres, have to say certain things. And so what really is driving the music is not people's values and attitudes here, but rather it is, the argument goes, the commercialization of that, that people who are paying the piper are literally and figuratively calling the tune. Is that what is going on here? Is that is what is taking place? This matting of how popular is popular music? Is it reflecting the music of the people? Or is it reflecting the music of the moneyed who are funding the people to stop, talk like this, think like this, say like this? This is a debate, and I hope our panelists and others will take it up. So sisters and brothers, we've talked about the types of Jamaican music and the time frame of it. We've talked about the themes of the music, talked about some techniques used in the music, and we have lifted up some thoughts about the Jamaican popular music. I hope this helps, and I hope this will be a base on which our panelists and our discussants and all of us can talk. Blessings, and thank you very much.